Well, see if this thing works.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
I think it's Monday today.
Yeah, we went through this. My computer doesn't have VGA out, so I stole this one. Found it lying on the street. Yeah. Okay. Type view passwords so everyone can see it.
It's a very nice picture.
Yeah, so as mentioned, kind of want to see how quickly you can get through the back material and into what's happening now and what we're seeing in our business. So we develop products for companies. Nobody's heard of us because the products we develop go at the door with somebody else's name on them. And most customers, we design and build the circuit boards going inside, and we ship them populated, tested boards. They assemble the product and away they go. So we'll touch on a few of those in the middle of this talk, or the early part. I brought a few toys, didn't get much time to look at some more of the stuff we brought. I was actually interested in one of the talk I gave at BCIT, how long ago? More than a dozen years ago, had our first development kit, which this is the mechanicals, the enclosure that was used on those, but this one is a completely different product. It's a TPC35A, which is a touch panel computer with a 3.5-inch touch screen, and it's got USB host and device and audio ports on this end. And this end has some development stuff. We got a serial debug port, Ethernet, power, but the board's actually scored about an inch in, so if you were building a handheld, the end with the connector snaps off, so that's for the developers and can be removed. But the first talk I gave at BCIT was with a computer this size, and we plugged in the VGA port on the back end. Presentation was on an MMC card done in an old version of OpenOffice, and that would have been the preferred way to go tonight, but instead we have a Windows computer here. Yes, a multimedia card. It might even have been an SD card, even though we didn't support the four-digit SD protocol, only the original MMC, one line in and out. It's basically a spy port. History of Linux up to 2000. We'll get into the talk here. Everybody's familiar with what happened. In the embedded world, we saw very, very little Linux before 2000. People were talking about it by the end of the 90s. It wasn't really used much. It was used on servers, but the embedded world, its use was very, very slim. Stuff I was doing prior to 2000 in some interesting circumstances. I was actually doing IC design when CMOS was brand new. As a result of the challenges of designing circuit boards on graph paper with 14 colors of colored pencils and then taking the every vertex of that and typing in XY coordinates onto a HP mini computer and running a compiler and then plotting it and watching the plotter drawing stuff and then go zzz, and then you go, oh, okay, there's a mistake, and 45 minutes of plotting later, and go in and fix things, decided it should be done interactively, so I got into graphics development and developed a CAD system from scratch, running a UCSDP system. This is before the original IBM PC came out. Ended up doing all my own device drivers, and we had the first graphics hardware accelerator. We had NEC computers. They were 640, 480, 1-bit each of red, green, blue on a 1K by 1K frame buffer. And I wrote x86 assembly language drivers for the 7220 graphics chip, which was the first graphics coprocessor. The computers actually had two of them, one running graphics mode, one running the text mode, and the outputs, the two of them on separate boards, went through ribbon cables into the hardware board that actually output the video, and they went through an exclusive OR gate. So you could be drawing stuff in graphics and be dumping text, and it would be streaming up the screen, and everything's done in hardware. Pretty neat. The computers were about $8,000 back in 81 or so, which was the price of a really nice used car.
How much today do you think?
Oh, I don't know. It would be a lot. Then I was working at Trionics. We were working on payment systems, embedded systems, all in hardware we were developing and so on. I actually wrote a relational database. I didn't know it was a relational database at the time. I didn't know that much about them, but over 15,000 lines of x86 assembly code. And that was used for decades on the payment systems. I don't have any of that old hardware here. We're doing credit card processing, self-serve stuff before anybody else was, from the mid-80s and so on. So it was an interesting experience, and of course working long hours, which gives you more experience. I think we're going to skip over a bunch of this stuff. We're running real-time operating systems on 16-bit processors. If anybody remembers when the NEC V20 chip came out and compared to Intel's 8088, it was about 30% faster. All kinds of neat features in there, like if we're converting values to dump as hex, you basically want to take a byte and split it into two nibbles and then add an ASCII zero to it. And you could use an instruction decimal adjust for addition. And it was for decimal. And it was a two-byte opcode in Intel. And the second byte happened to be 0A, hex, 10. And I played around. And you could take the second byte, hack the instructions, put in 10 hex, and that now did a divide by 10. AH was the result of dividing, and AL was the remainder. So now you've got your byte split into nibbles. NEC optimized that, and you could put any value in the second byte, and it didn't care. It did the divide by 10, so broke my optimizations, but I now had a way in software where I could tell if you're running a genuine Intel processor or NEC. We were authorizing credit cards over a 485 network, everything done in software, in under a second back in 1985 and 86. I used to get really frustrated at the BC Ferries terminal 5 years later when they were taking a few minutes for every credit card. So I'm going to fast forward here. 1999, we got in our first ARM project. I was looking for an excuse to develop ARM hardware. We were doing x86. We used like AMD chips. We used the AMD CC 186 CC, AM 186 CC, which had a USB port on board, and a device for physio control. A lot of challenges with that. Drivers didn't work. We're way behind on the project. If you're working on a project and you're not getting technical support because you're a small company, we kind of hit the wall on support. So instead of talking to AMD's tech support people, I phoned them up and I asked to talk to the legal department. And they asked me what I wanted, and I said, I'm developing this stuff on this defibrillator product. My customer has more lawyers than my company has staff, and it's not going well, and I'm afraid we might get sued, and it's running your chip, so I'm afraid you guys could potentially get sued as well, because the USB stuff doesn't work. And they scheduled a call 2 days later, early in the morning. Got a conference call, and the fellows introduced themselves. VP of technology in charge of chip design, the VP of software support services, the chief engineer on the software side, and the software programmer who wrote the USB drivers. How can we help you? It moved a lot faster after that.
I want to use that technique.
Yeah.
It only works once, though.
Yeah, trying to read. I can't really see. Anyways, we got a contract down in Seattle for a company called Play Networks. Everybody's familiar with, you get in the elevator and Muzak, people think of Muzak, which is a real company, but not the only company. The four biggest ones include Play Networks, and they're the background music in Starbucks, Nordstrom, JCPenney, Kmart, Boston Market, and all this stuff. So that was our We used a Cirrus Logic ARM 7. There weren't a lot of production ARM chips back then. Atmel got in just after that. We used Hynix Hyundai later, but I'm trying to think if there's anybody else in North America besides Cirrus Logic back then. I think they might have been the only one. That was not Linux, but we did get our feet wet in 32-bit processors, and we discovered they're a lot more complicated than the 8 and 16-bit processors. Even challenges like trying to get the computer up and running, and it's not working, and we've got the, you know, the crystal seems to be oscillating. There's also a watch crystal on it, which we didn't install because we weren't running a real-time clock. And we found out after a while that when the power comes on, the processor doesn't run off the main crystal. It actually runs a state machine, almost like a mini processor inside, that runs off the watch crystal. And that goes through and checks some pins for how the hardware is configured and sets up a bunch of things. And after it decides that everything's ready, then it turns on the real processor. And yeah.
Sorry, do processors actually have crystals inside of them?
No, the crystal's external, the oscillator, but yeah, because crystals are, well, that's a different technology than the processor, so it's not very compatible with the same production line. But a lot of the small micros now do run an oscillator, and some of them ship with laser trimmed, and the tolerances are good enough. They're pretty steady, so there's a lot of them where you've got a 4 megahertz clock on board. You don't need the external one.
Yeah, and you're saying the 32 bits were a lot more complicated than the 16 bits. Was this primarily just due to the hardware they had to deal with, or did the assembly language change?
Well, it's ARM assembly language, so that was more complicated.
Was 32-bit on ARM?
Yeah.
Interesting.
ARM processors, ARM 720T. 720 is the old school ARM chips where they're actually a physical mask that you license, the layout of the chip. The newer ones, like we, 2005, we switched to Samsung 2410, it was S3C 2410A. That was an ARM 920T, ARM 9, but all the future ARMs that they did would be a 926 EJS, which J is the Giselle, Java, basically runs Java opcodes internally, but the S is the main difference. S is synthesizable, so you're no longer getting the layout of the transistor layers for your process. You're getting a big file of equations to implement on your ASIC-type technology. And all the newer ones are, almost all of them, I believe, are all synthesizable parts now.
And so you've worked with both x86 embedded and ARM embedded?
Yeah.
ARM... Is the assembly language, is assembly code a lot better than the x86? Because I always hear that x86 is kind of infamous for being kind of horrid to develop.
You almost never ever use assembly language on the ARM processors, except maybe at some of the very initial startup stuff. There's no reason to do it for speed. Everything's one instruction per clock. It's like the original IBM PC, the 14.31818 crystal, which was chosen because it's a color burst crystal. Crystals used to be expensive, but that was in every color TV, so it was the cheapest crystal you could buy. So a 5 megahertz processor that could run 15 was 3.8, but it's actually divided by 3 to get the T states, so you're at 4, they call it at 4.77 megahertz, but the x86 language took several instructions from a no-op being 4 T states, so you're basically a million no-ops a second, to some divide instructions like 83 clocks, so it would take 20 microseconds to do a single instruction. But in ARM, everything is a single instruction per clock. The only time you have issues are branches in your code. So you've got a queue. ARM runs, you know, off the fact that it's got a big cache and things are in the queue and runs very fast. In fact, when the first time somebody benchmarked an ARM processor against Motorola's 68000 at a trade show back in the mid 80s, the guy from Motorola said, that's just a memory. Cache memory chip with a little processor in the corner. We're not worried about that. That's not competition. yeah, we pretty much never do assembly language, though. The compilers are good. Everything runs fast. And the new parts, even ones that are under a dollar, they'll be 48 or 72 megahertz. So we're running, you know, 72 million instructions a second versus the original IBM PC was almost a million a second, so like 100 times the speed. more RAM than the PC had on board.
So suffice to say, it's ARM is a better architecture in your opinion than compared to x86.
We do a lot of portable products and stuff, and the power consumption is very low, so that's a big factor. For products that aren't portable, the low power is an issue with heat.
Yeah.
So if you're sticking an embedded controller in a factory that's hot and they want to install it this date, this year, and have it still running in a decade, if it's got a fan in there, it's not going to be working in a decade, right? So it avoids all those issues with the cooling and stuff as well.
There are lots of
VanLUG
computers,
though. Yeah, there are. And the x86 is getting a lot closer to ARM in price now. It's closer every year. So we got this voice audio player for background music, a contract down in Seattle. Developed it with an ARM processor. It was a ton of work. The cool thing is, we had a hard drive interface. We had AMX offered, KDAC offered a DOS compatible file system bolt on for AMX. We needed to play MP3s. Found an open source project, Mad Player. Whole bunch of work to get that going. We had to write our own CD file system because CDs are 14 bits per sample. So, what is it, every 8 samples you've got 7 16-bit words or something. You got to jumble them, put them together. It was a real... Yeah. So when we had the system done, it all worked, nice little embedded box, and I thought this would be really cool to sell to people for playing music, or back then, cars, one of the big options was a CD changer to go in the trunk. We'd hold like 6 CDs, and they were lots of money, and I thought, oh, we could put this little hard drive unit in there. And then Toshiba came out with their 1¾-inch hard drive, and then that's really cool because it's lower powered, smaller. I thought, instead of putting it in the car, now we could build a handheld with a hard drive on it playing music. And I did some costing, and I worked out that building 1,000 at a time or something, the hard drives were expensive, close to 200. So it's going to cost $300 to build this product. If you built it, you'd have to sell the thing for like $600. End customer, this isn't going to work. Nobody's going to pay $600 for a portable media player. And almost a year, almost a year ago later to the date, the original iPod came out at $599 US. Sold like crazy.
It wasn't $600.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, well. Would have cost a lot to get that Apple logo. We had a whole bunch of engineers working in this. Like, we're known as a hardware company. A couple of years later, while we're developing our computer modules, we had at the peak, I think, 10 programmers, full-time programmers on staff, one of them a PhD from SFU. It was on this other project, we didn't have that many people. It was still a bunch. By the time we had this media player going, running on a commercial RTOS on the hardware at the point where we can do kind of application stuff, the bill was $250,000 in development costs. That's a problem if every project we're going to build is $250,000. So.
Is it the cost only for that project, or is
that's what the customer paid in hourly consulting to get the PCBs designed and the software for the drivers
so
on it and everything.
Only the cost
for that project, for the engineering, yeah, not any hardware costs. So the idea back then, there were 32-bit processors. There was Intel x86, Motorola, MIPS, Hitachi, SH, ARM. And ARM was kind of behind the others. Then one year it was number one by volume. The next year, ARM exceeded all the others combined. So kind of looking at what's happening there and the costs, and I'm thinking all the companies doing engineering like us are going to get pushed into these 32-bit processors and 32-bit operating systems. And this is taking way too long to get out the door, so I thought, well, if we could put the technology onto a computer module, we could speed up the development process, get the contracts done quicker, maybe even make some profit on them. And then the plan A was we could sell this to other companies so they didn't have to go through the learning curve. And then plan B was, well, if nobody else wants to buy our hardware, we'll just use it for our own development and speed things up. So I was set to work in 2000 with no real fixed budget and no idea how long it would take. I planned to get these out the door in less than a year, and 2 years later we had the development kits and put them out on the internet. The first order was from Canon headquarters in Tokyo, Japan. And we shipped an average of about one a week for the first couple of years. So we were Linux on ARM, and that's all we did after that for a long time, just Linux on ARM technology, developing a lot of different products. That was an early touchscreen with 3.5. This is a later one that different customers have used for terminals. It's got dual Ethernet ports, 3.5-inch touchscreen. We had Qt on there, but most people were using GTK. And then there's challenges getting a customer. Unfortunately, we were kind of a Linux university, because most of our customers came to us wanting to use Linux because of the price, but had no Linux experience, and we had to get them going and teach them and stuff. So,
can I ask a question? Was there ever a doubt that ARM may or may not succeed, or was it like
there was no idea what was going to be the leader?
Yeah, when you first started developing with ARM, was it like, oh, it's clear ARM has a foothold in this market? Because like, I only really started hearing about ARM when the smartphones came out, right?
Yeah.
And then they started, you know, like, oh, ARM is now, you know, multi-core, you know, multi-gigahertz.
Yeah. MIPS was proprietary way back. Hitachi SH was only on chips sold by Hitachi. X86 was Intel and AMD, and there were the other small players doing Cyrix and stuff like that, but not very much. And then the 68000 was Motorola. So all these were proprietary, and ARM was selling the design, and everybody that was interested in building a processor could use that. So it was catching this like critical mass. By the end of the 90s, it was taking off. In the early 90s, early 2000s, Philips had some type of a deal with ARM where I think they paid some kind of a flat rate. So there's 52 weeks in the year. Philips released over 80 new ICs powered by ARM chips a year. They were doing more.
What's the patent dispute between Intel and ARM? Do you know anything about that?
No.
Intel had to buy like a big share of ARM or something.
Is it related to Intel selling
Xscale? No, I don't remember. I just vaguely remember there was some kind of patent dispute, and they settled up, but Intel bought a $400 million equity stake in ARM or something.
So yeah, not familiar with that. There was interesting stuff with Intel, because Digital Equipment Corp, DEC, had the only ARM license in the world where you could modify the ARM core. And when DEC went under and was divided up and sold off, and Intel bought the strong ARM license, they got that license. So they were the only people that could actually monkey with it and play with it. And at one point I was talking to the head of Intel Ventures at a meeting here in Vancouver, and we were talking about the processors, and he told me, because of AMD and stuff, that the PC world was too competitive and there wasn't much in the way of profit there, and the embedded world was the future. There's going to be more embedded stuff. And he said that Intel's long-term plans were to get out of the PC processors and go with the embedded ones. And then a few years after that, they sold the strong ARM off to which? At that point, yeah, it already changed to the X-Scale, the next generation.
Intel sold the X-Scale to Marvell.
Yeah, Marvell. Yeah, I was under NDA with Marvell, never actually used their chips. But somebody, I don't know, probably the bean counters decided that these $300 Pentium chips looked like a better deal, and I think they're probably trying to backpedal now and trying to get, you know, all this, like Roland said, fanless computers and stuff to compete with ARM, and not competing very well. Sure. Yeah, so that's a...
Well, that's my other question. Are you saying that ARM is not proprietary like the others?
ARM is... The chip design belongs to ARM, but they license it to anybody that wants to build ARM chips. So
you can look at the code, you can change it.
You're not allowed to change it except for the one license that DEC had that went to Intel, that went to Marvell. But everybody's building chips in the early 2000s. Atmel was in that game, Samsung. If you get a Samsung hard drive, there's an ARM processor on there that runs about 40 hertz. They used to have one that was an ARM 940T, and an ARM 940 was basically the 920 core, but without the MMU on it, so it reduced the cost. It wasn't running Linux or anything, but you know, when you buy a hard drive, you've got another processor in your computer. They pretty well all the processors. The original hard drives. I'm not sure about the SSDs. Roland might be, he's the SSD expert. Yeah, a couple computers here. This is predates our ARM stuff. This is just an example of some of the wacky stuff we were doing. This is a smart card payment terminal that originally took Mondex and Visa cash. This is from the mid-90s. And the company had another company designed a board with a $5 NEC processor that cost about $140 to build. And when they put it in a box, it had $200 worth of cables. And they would, and it took most of a day to assemble one unit. And as the guy got the last kind of cable almost plugged in, then boing, one of the other ones popped off in there. It was a disaster. And I designed this platform with boards that plug in. This is the interface to the vending machine, and there's different varieties of this on a backplane. The connectors are 29 cents Canadian. The backplane runs a PIC micro, which has a display soldered to it. The push buttons contact direct on the PCB. And the micro was, I can't remember, a few dollars back then. And for different machines, we did a different interface card. And then there's one down here that interfaces to the smart cards. And it had a PIC 16C50 or 55. That was an expensive chip, like $5, $6. And then for Visa cards, we've had an AMD 186 board on here. Without the AMD one, so we've got three boards with three processors. The BOM cost was 100 Canadian instead of around 150 US. Everything ran better. The Atlanta Olympics, which company, Coke, was using, Visa had a smart card, Visa cash card way back, and Coke was taking that. So they had these in the Coke machines down in Atlanta taking Mondex and Visa. And smart cards are going to take off in North America next year. For the last 20 years, it's next year it's going to take off. Yeah. I got one other toy to pass around, and this is from wearable computer stuff. This is a hub. We've got a bunch of the computers in our office. They're 2.5 inches square, with a VGA port for a head mount display. And the USB host port, there's a jumper on here. It's got a couple switching power supplies. The battery packs plug in here. You can hot swap battery packs, so one's getting low. The LEDs give you a status. And switch to another one, hook up your peripherals, like your Twiddler cording keyboard and all that stuff. And if you put this jumper in place, then it also powers out the USB device port, USB going the wrong way, but that powers your wearable computer.
So you don't want that master.
Yeah, it's actually old. We got this board done, ready to build, and the off-the-shelf case from PacTech or somebody, they discontinued right when we were ready to build them. So, that one's not in the case. We grab it by the metal connectors, it's fine. I was doing computer stuff. Actually, this bag is from the 7th IEEE International Symposium on Wearable Computers in White Plains, New York in 2003. I was a judge for the student contest then. Met a lot of great people. Anybody here into the old wearable computer stuff? Recognize names like Thad Starner from Carnegie Mellon. Thad had all his computer gear on him with taking video, everything 24/7. He was married for 3 years before his wife convinced him to remove the computer for sex. And then there was Steve. I said he wore this computer 24/7. After 3 years, his wife convinced him to take it off while they're having sex at least. And then Steve Mann, University of Toronto, he went to a conference at Memorial University, and when he was getting on the plane to come home, the security wouldn't let him wear his head mount computer, so he wouldn't leave. And he kind of flipped out. He said, no, that's part of him. He was officially a cyborg.
And sounds like Google Glass, where people are wearing those things in the bathrooms. And inappropriate places. You know?
Yeah. So I don't know how we're doing for time here. Oh no, no, don't go back to the.
They actually made a joke on YouTube. Don't be a glass bowl.
Oh yeah.
So it didn't. We programmed the firmware and the software for this. So native is your primary gear to be using.
Pardon?
When you had to program the firmware for your hardware. Were you doing assembly?
You know, my programmers were running whichever editor. The stuff I was working on back in the 80s, we were usually running the Brief editor. Does anybody remember Brief?
Yes.
Basic reconfigurable interactive editing facility. And you could have, like, you could split the screen up and you'd have 8 documents open at the same time. And you can do a search and replace on one, or you could do a search and replace on the directory. And you know, if you want to change a function name, you could just blip do it on everything back in the DOS days. So I think, because my guys are all coming from back in the 80s, that we had, I forget, there was a clone of it on Linux.
Crisp
user back there, and I used that for a while. Our customers, though, we had a lot of them want to use IDEs and Eclipse, but most of what we did was all command line, and people would just use whatever Emacs and Vim.
Did you say that was a smart card reader, or is it a credit card reader?
Smart card. Yeah. It's got landing contacts. The cheap, like the smart card reader in a satellite box, you hardly ever put the card in or out, so it's a sliding contact that slides, but in a payment device, you'd wear out the contacts really quick, so it's a landing contact, and the part with the contacts is towards the front, and as the card goes in and hits, it goes through a wedge system, where as they go to the back, it pushes down on it without sliding.
What's the Ethernet port for?
It's not Ethernet, it's the connector for, which one was that, for communications?
Serial, yeah.
Yeah, we're using serial communications and data collection, I think, out of a standard for Visa. And then later we developed, it was kind of cool, we built a little circuit board that was 30 thou thick instead of the usual 62 thou that plugged into the smart card with the slot with the pads on it, and then took the pins off that through a converter to a big 25-pin D9. So we were able to we would detect that we had this unit in there. We do all the communications from the front of the vending machine without having to open it up.
So what kind of data is contained on the chip in the smart card?
Oh, they vary from things with 100 bytes to ones with megabytes. Yeah. Yeah, there's big players in that area, Atmel and Schlumberger.
Is it like some kind of private key, public key?
There's a bunch of different security encryption schemes on them as well, depending on the different chips.
How do you know which card is which? How do you identify the individual card?
In a Mondex system, Mondex is a really nice system for smart cards, and the if you're looking at The card on the bottom, you'll see it actually has SIM card holders like a cell phone before people, very many had SIM cards and cell phones in the payment terminal there. And the merchant has their own merchant card and it plugs into there. And all you're doing when somebody buys something is you're moving money off the customer's card to the merchant card. Everything's encrypted. We don't actually decrypt the financial information. The messages are going back and forth. All we're doing is pushing messages around. There's some non-encoded messages saying what the value is. So if the Coke is $2, we're telling it we want to do $2. And you talk to both of them that they're ready to do $2, and then one spits out a message and you write it to the other one, and the other one sends a message back, it's okay. So then you go, okay, release the Coke. And
does that work the same way as NFC, near field communication?
Yeah, in the payments world, NFC is a communications link talking to the smart card technology, which was also originally first the contactless smart cards that run at 13.5 megahertz. Mm-hmm. And that's what all your bank cards are with the tap and go system.
And I know the Compass system for transit is NFC.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh,
so yeah, it's like it is. Yeah. You can get an NFC application on
it. Oh, yes, right, you can hack them. Yeah, you can hack Compass, yeah.
And you can
hack
Compass, yeah.
I need that to get home tonight.
Yeah, don't have any money for the bus, just hack
yeah.
No, I think the original question was actually which languages are used for the firmware, not which environment or text editor is used.
Oh, the stuff we're doing, the customers role, mostly C, C++. Actually, because... Not on that. No, I thought you were talking about the Linux development systems.
No, I think the original question was which languages are used, programming languages are used for the firmware.
On which products?
Well, mostly, I was just asking in general, which were the ones that you first worked with,
oh.
And later on.
Assembly language in C, and then,
C&C?
Yeah. And tons of C code. And then, and the Linux system, C++, obviously. I'm going to talk in here about the weaknesses. The learning curve on Linux for developers is a big problem. And because of that, getting the tools going, one of the things we did was support languages that didn't need the cross-compilers. So I've spent six figures on Java ports, first Sun's J2ME CDC, and then later IBM's J9. When Sun was in financial trouble, they solution was to raise their royalty prices on everything, and then IBM, and then we had Cacao for the free Java, but then Python was taking off. So I think the press release on PyGDK support was how long ago?
2009.
Yeah, where we had the demo with a whole bunch of color wheels and stuff running on the Linux desktop with our touchscreen computer in front and the exact same graphics looking almost the exact same.
So you're using Java primarily for like the front end, right?
Yeah, people would use it for the applications running. The graphics were a challenge. We're running AWT, java.awt, and people are wanting Swing, and you have to explain, well, Swing was written for portability. It's a brain dead GUI that gives you, basically it's like a basic peek and poke of a pixel, and everything is layers on top of that, versus Java AWT is a real GUI with optimized code. So we had the Java AWT graphics on the, on the system.
Excuse me for my ignorance, but so you had to run, if it was Java, you had to run a virtual machine, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, it must have had a huge footprint. It must have needed a lot of memory.
And it took quite a bit. We stripped a few things down, kept the core things. It was fairly large. We had one of our bigger clients for industrial computers was Schneider Electric, and their applications were Java. And I think we started with them on the ARM7s, on the Hynix processors. We had...
Do
we have 64K, I guess mid, push up to the mid-2000s, because then we went to the 2410. The old ARM7 was EDO memory and disk-on-chip storage, and then the 2410 we had NAND flash running on SD-RAM. So we could run Java on a machine with 32 megs of memory with basically nothing left for applications and logging. But Java with GUIs, we're doing 64 megs of memory. But even with their applications running, we would typically have over 20 megs of free space in the RAM while it's running. So it wasn't too bad. I was down in Memphis at the sorting facility for is that FedEx or UPS? FedEx there, right? Yeah. And that place is amazing. Could give a talk about that. But they had people doing sorting and scanning. They've got three different levels of machines, and they've got four different conveyor belts, one from each operator, all feeding onto the same conveyor belt. And the conveyor belt has plastic buckets. And the conveyor speeds are timed so that it shoots the box or package. Now, this could be an envelope or it could be a bigger box. It shoots it off the conveyor belt so it lands in one of these plastic buckets. And the buckets, they're going across. There's, I'm trying to remember, four stations, 16 workers on each side. And the conveyor belts go across, and the distribution is lengthwise, about 20 different conveyor belts going to be feeding planes to different areas. And as the bucket gets across the right conveyor belt underneath it, it does a dump. It's like the back end of a Tonka truck there. It dumps the package in. And everything is built 4 feet off the floor. So everything's on a metal scaffolding. And you can look underneath, and this building's almost the size of a football field. But underneath, you can see right through to the other side. And they have to go through every couple days and get the small packages and envelopes that missed the bucket. So when your package doesn't show up the next day, you know, check for dust on it. It's been underneath the equipment there. Yeah, interesting stuff. Unfortunately, our software partner that they selected in New Mexico, I went down there because he kept saying our 485 ports weren't working, and I got down there, discovered his software didn't work, but he was there, we weren't, so he blamed our equipment. We proved it worked, but they never got the software going, so we never got sale. But
Yeah.
But I got to have hush puppies for dinner in Memphis there.
Can you leave a JTAG or UART headers on your products?
Yeah, and the newer stuff, you can't see any of the processors in our newer stuff. There's a JTAG connector unpopulated on the bottom of our newer computer boards. They have all the parts in the top, and we don't populate them. My main low-level engineers had JTAG hooked up in the past, but basically he puts in printfs, printks, things like that. You blink a LED and have the scope on it to see what's going on.
Yeah, we don't use. Messing around with routers is if I break a router, I'll try JTAG to recover the firmware.
Oh yeah, and reflash it. Yeah. Yeah, most of these chips, like the we had Samsung and now Freescale, and they've got multiple bootloaders. So they'll boot off the SD flash we use, and they'll boot off serial spy memory and different things, and they'll also boot off USB. So they've got a bunch of boot pins on them. We've got our products, the I.O. boards have five jumpers for boot selection. So the customer uses a utility, usually if it's bricked, and you can force it to boot over USB.
So you can unbrick it easily.
Yeah. Yeah, and then you can also, we've got the old ones, we actually sold the customers a little programming board. One of the things I did with our computer modules, the first generation where they were booting off a parallel NOR flash, normally people take the x86 boots at high memory and ARM boots at bottom, at zero. So your chip select zero goes to your ROM flash chip. I didn't do that. I ran the chip select of the onboard ROM and the chip select from the processor out to pins off board next to each other. So on a production board, you just take those two pins on your board, connect them up, and you plug in the computer and it boots off the onboard. But our programming board had another NOR flash on it, and we had a nice little 2x2 jumper there, and if you rotate the jumpers, the processor boots off the flash on the programming board, and the flash that's on the processor is on chip select 2 or something. So it'll boot up and reprogram it. And we had this all done with scripts, and it had an SD card, so we just had to tell them, you know, what format a file, and you'd take your brick board, plug it in, power it up, and 30 seconds later it was reflashed.
I wish a lot of companies would take that example. It sucks having a $3,000 paperweight because it's brick.
yeah, definitely. So getting back into Linux here, looking at the normal SWOT analysis, if you're going to develop a product or something, then you go through, you know, the strengths and weaknesses of your product, what the opportunities are, and what the threats are. So looking at Linux under this, you know, strengths, there's a lot of them. The really big things in product development for us with Linux is the graphics and GUIs, which the embedded world was really weak on. And even the old GUIs used in the embedded world, like PEG from Swell Software and FLTK. Has anybody used FLTK?
First thing I learned to program it.
Yeah. We used FLTK for a handheld for a Silicon Valley company, a bunch of scary Russian guys in modified BMWs. And they took it and had their programming team basically redo the widgets, so they customized it, but it's really fast. It's small, it's really fast. The stock widgets were looking old-fashioned, but they changed that stuff. And then, of course, there's the file systems and database support. You got everything under the sun, and then communications and protocols. So basically, in the older days, when people are talking about their product, they're saying if you're going to be storing data, you're hooking up to the internet, or if you want a GUI, you want to run Linux. Otherwise, you can do it without running Linux, but you're going to spend a ton of money on software development. And one of the examples, just a quick one, putting Wi-Fi on an embedded product. So if you've got a Linux processor running on an ARM processor, it's got a USB host. Most of the stuff we build has got a 4-port hub on it. So you get a USB Wi-Fi module out of China for $4, and it's got a Realtek chip or something on it. It really doesn't matter much whose chip. And you plug it in, and there's drivers, and all this stuff works. And the guy who says, oh, no, I don't want to spend the money on that processor for Linux, I'm just going to use this little embedded processor, it's only $3, and the BOM for running Linux, the processor and RAM and flash, that's $10. I'm going to save $7. Then he wants to put Wi-Fi on, and he's shopping around, and he's got these Wi-Fi modules that have a serial port built in and a protocol, and they're $20. So now he's spending $16 more to get the hardware on there for Wi-Fi. And then comes the fun part. It's a proprietary API to talk to this company's chip. So then you write the software for that. And then comes the fun part. It doesn't work because it's full of bugs, because they're a small company and they don't have high volumes. And you spend a whole bunch more time on the software development. It's kind of like Windows CE was similar. I remember one developer who worked on CE products and said CE was great. You get 90% through your development in a matter of a few weeks because you're using the stock components, and then you get into the driver side, and that's where you start on the 90% of the development cost, getting the last 10% of it going. But you got all these issues with things like Wi-Fi support. It's expensive, and then standards change, and you get a new module, and your workarounds for the bugs in the API don't apply because they fix those bugs, but there's new bugs and so on. So the stability is a big factor with Linux. You've got a known quantity. Portability, even going back, you know, Linio days, hard hat Linux. Then we went through Angstrom, build systems, and Yocto. And the applications run across everything. So that's a big strength of Linux. People that aren't doing Linux say, oh, you don't want to run Linux because it's, you know, it's forked and there's 100 different distributions out there. So as far as they're concerned, it's broken because there's so many distributions, when the reality is that different distributions have different things built into them or optimized for doing different things, and it's a strength. You've got some for servers and some for desktop and some for small systems.
Windows CE was a different kernel than it was a completely different kernel, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. It was originally the Auto PC.
Do they still have two different kernels for Windows Embedded?
Yeah.
One for Windows Embedded and one for Windows?
Yeah, yeah, the Auto PC failed terribly and everybody stopped building Auto PCs, and Microsoft threw several million dollars at Jensen to keep building products, and they built till they ran out of money and it died, and then the marketing guys gave it a spin, and then it became Windows CE, and that went and almost died, and then how many names has it had between Windows CE and Windows Mobile now?
What kept changing is the name of, how do you say, the name of the, this like operating system, the product that uses Windows CE, because it's originally it's
based on Windows 98.
Pocket PC, yeah. Mobile.
Oh yeah, those Pocket PC.
Yeah, like five versions, and if they updated the version, you can't, your software doesn't run.
Yeah.
Apple brand, so it's like, well, why even buy it if it's disposable, right?
A colleague of mine down in Redmond was coming back from, I can't remember, Embedded Systems Conference, I think, on the plane to Seattle. And they got talking to the guy next to him, and he said, what are you doing? He's an embedded developer. And the guy goes, oh, really? He says, I work for Microsoft on Windows CE and stuff. He said, and the guy is telling him this big sales pitch on why he should use CE. And then he said, what kind of products do you develop? And he says, I work at Physiocontrol. We work on FDA Class 3 life support devices. And the guy from Microsoft wouldn't talk to him anymore. Didn't want him running Microsoft. Anyways, discussing the issues when the advantage of Linux, weaknesses on Linux. Now this is the interesting part. So the size of complexity. So there's some people that have been here using it more than 10 years. I've used it on my desktop more than 10 years, going back to Mandrake and SUSE, back when they were tied in with, was there something to do with Corel and ops and stuff? Yeah. But a lot of people are using it, but who's really familiar with how the kernel's working, the task scheduling, preemption, and so on? It's just so big and complex, you just hope all that stuff works. You never have to look at it because you don't want to get mucking about. So it's big and complex. But the positive side of that, you don't need to be familiar with all that stuff because it works and it's reliable. One of the issues we've hit, boot time. So in embedded systems, everybody's familiar with Nuance, or a lot of people are most familiar with another, should be a Nuance trademark called Siri, which is Nuance voice going to a search backend. Anyways, Nuance are the people in the telephones 20 years ago when you go 411 and what city, business, or residential type thing. The leaders in the voice technology. And they bought a company. We were working on terminals for printers for tracking printing expenses. The company has 60% of the legal market. If anybody's ever bought a house or done anything with the lawyers, you get a bill and everything's detailed down there, and you're paying possibly a dollar a page for every fax they put out, and a dollar for every, was that more? Yeah.
I used to work at a big
law firm. Yeah. So we developed the new terminals for them. The old one had a two-line LCD on an RTOS, and they gave us a spec. They decided, we talked about this, Android would be better for GUIs because getting Android developers is easier. We ported Android to Freescale's IMX 283, basically the only port on the planet of 2.3.6. Finalize that?
2.3.6
or .7. Huge amount of work. That was a six-figure investment. So their spec was it had to be up and running within 60 seconds. And we had to do a whole bunch of work to get Linux up in 30 seconds and then another 30 seconds for Android, pulling all kinds of stuff out of Android. We also had to add stuff. The basic Android system doesn't have, you know, it's all Java. It doesn't have Java, whatever the .com classes. So you've got serial ports on these devices and Android doesn't come with support for them. We had to bolt that onto Android. But we just barely squeaked in with a 60 second boot time. Now if you build, take an RTOS on a simple processor and you're talking to a display, you can have the display up in under a second on a normal system. So the boot time is a really big issue. One we've been running into, power management. Linux has got so many features, how come it doesn't have power management? No standard interface for battery management chips, the charger ICs, you know, the Coulomb counter chips that are used for your fuel gauges. It's 2016, it's not there.
You don't buy stuff there? Like, is it?
No. Other than, well, you don't need it on a server. And when people build a custom product, they do a lot of work on the power management themselves. Even the laptops running Windows. Microsoft does squat for power management. Everybody making a laptop does all their own work behind on power management. So maybe it's just an attitude in the industry that power management doesn't come from your OS. You have to do it yourself.
So but you think that if you were to submit a patch to the Linux kernel adding this feature in, and you don't think it would get accepted?
I'm not sure actually how to address it other than I think there needs to be, first thing is a standard API for power management, and then if there was, then maybe the Texas Instruments and other people in the world that are making power control chips might actually write Linux drivers for their chip if there was something to write to, but there's no API there. So look at the threats. So what's happened in the embedded world? We've gone from these small micros with small numbers of peripherals and not a lot of software support into this world nowadays where the chip makers, I guess for competitive reasons, well, there's two things that happened. One is the embedded micros have all migrated to ARM. So they're all running the same core, and they put their own peripherals around it, but basically they don't have a competitive advantage on the core compared to another vendor because everybody's got an ARM processor on there. So they've gone after the development tools. Is anybody working with embedded Freescale parts, the Kinetis Design Studio?
Yes.
Yeah?
Well, I'm using it as a weird flash. I'm not actually using the environment API.
Oh yeah, but the old days, the RTOS stuff was very simple. They've got so many more features in that stuff now that it's a lot more complicated. I wanted to do some software work. We've got a project we're working on right now that'll have three low-end micros and then standard Linux one doing the GUIs and Wi-Fi and things. And I started, I think it was Boxing Day, was that a Friday or Saturday? And installing software and trying things and Google searches as to why stuff doesn't work. And the next Saturday, which was January 1st or whatever, Saturday around just before 6 p.m., I actually got stuff working. And we're closed between Christmas and Saturday. So I was at work, you know, like 40 hours to get all this stuff going. But it's complicated GUIs. You have one tool that you go into and you say how many serial ports you want, how many SPI ports versus UART ports and pulse width modulators and so on. Because these chips are so complicated and each pin has five different things it can do, they have software to manage that for you and create a pinout specification. But the important part is it generates all the startup code to configure the chip for you. So you're not doing that stuff anymore in the embedded world. When we're working on an ARM processor, we're still working on startup code to configure things, but on these low-end chips, they've got tools to do all that. And then you get into their GUIs, and all of a sudden there's all kinds of support for for operating systems and also drivers. So I've got a little list here, partial one of some free RTOSs, which includes free RTOS. MQX is from Freescale. It's only free on their chips, but there's a ton of them in here. There's a few of them that I've got. Low-cost RTOS options, AMX I've used, friends use CMX. Salvo I was looking at, it's really tiny. That was for the MSP430s. And then the higher-cost RTOSs, Nucleus, very old. QNX is a really good one, but it's bought by BlackBerry, so I'm not sure how available it is. In terms of competition for Linux, Microsoft, now with ARM support again. They're going to try getting into embedded. I remember years back they had an embedded version of Windows NT, and they promised, no, you can use Windows. We're going to support it for a really, really long time. We're serious about embedded, and they discontinued it within a year.
And this is why Windows can run on a Raspberry Pi?
Their new version one's on ARM. I remember being at an embedded systems conference, and there's a company called Win Systems. They just build x86 computers. And I was talking to the sales guy there, and he says, oh, you want to see something really funny? He says, come look at this demo. We've got this real-time embedded version of Windows. And hooked up to the computer, we've got a little board here, and it's got seven or so LEDs on it. And every half second or something, it moves to the next LED, and at the end, it moves back. And he says, watch it for a bit. And this is real-time embedded, real-time Windows. And it goes back, and it goes back, and it goes back, goes back. And after about 3 seconds, it stops. And it stops for a few seconds, and then it starts moving again. It goes back and forth. And 10 seconds later, it stops for a few seconds. Unavailable. It was pretty funny. So, don't see Microsoft as a threat. Now, Brolin mentioned, this is the area that's looking kind of fun because there's these real-time operating systems that are POSIX compliant. I haven't got into NutX, but it's used on small micros. Like the MKL25Z is a Cortex-M3 from Freescale. And depending how much RAM and flash it has, these things start, I don't know, around $1.50 or something. We're talking really cheap hardware, and as I mentioned in here, it supports USB host ports, USB gadget ports, has flash-oriented file systems, and supports BSD sockets, and they even got a bit of a graphics system. The one I've been interested in is RTEMS. It's usually on higher-end processors. The acronym has gone through three different variations. It was a real-time executive for missile systems. This is the operating system used in the US cruise missiles. It's reliable. It was developed under contract, I forget which university, a bunch of PhD pointy-headed people working on this thing. It was really good, and it was so popular because it was small and reliable that they started using it all over in the military, so the acronym got renamed, and it's Real-Time Executive for Military Systems. But it kind of got out into the wild, and people are using it on all types of things, and now they've extended it to cores with multiple processors, so I believe it's now Real-Time Executive for Multiprocessor Systems, and it'll have a different name in a couple of years. But it's all at the driver level, so it's real-time, it's screaming fast, but at the driver level, it's compatible with Linux. So if a new Ethernet chip comes out, and they put out Linux support for it, you've got Linux support in this kernel. Except your system from power on to operating is under a second instead of waiting 30 seconds or a minute. Even Google was using this in the summer of code, and they're doing all kinds of stuff. So backing up, we're saying Linux excels communications and protocols, databases, file systems, GUIs, and the RTOS options were not supporting these areas. But now the chip developers are offering all this additional support in their RTOSs. So USB on the go, host device, Ethernet, some of these micros have built in built-in Mac. Some of them even have the PHY chip. Even IEEE 1588 for synchronizing devices over networking. And they're just starting to add Wi-Fi support. So you go into this Kinetis Design Studio, and after you define all your pinouts, and you go into the software, and you start going through things, and one of the options is your operating system, and it's radio buttons. Are you running, Roland, do you remember any of these options? They've got a choice of FreeRTOS, QMX, QMX Lite, and then there's three or four others. And they've got all their software, so the drivers are talking to, they've got abstraction layers. You could actually click on one of these, pick that RTOS, get halfway through your development and decide, oh, I want the messaging features in this other RTOS, go back in your configuration file, change the RTOS, rebuild, and now you're running off that other operating system. That's pretty cool. And none of them have an option for Linux in there. So in database file systems, the controller in this device we're doing, this scientific instrument, we're running a new processor that just came out from Freescale, the 82L, and it's got quad SPI support. And I think basically it's a chip that looks an awful lot like an SDIO. It's got four data lines in parallel and a clock, and you talk to it about reading sectors. But they've got all the support in the RTOS for the low level, and then they've got a virtual FAT file system on top of it. So it makes it pretty easy to write code. And this one's a really expensive processor. I think it's around $5. The other ones we're using are under $1 in this thing.
Here's a question. What were the first file systems that you were using? What's your preferred file system to use today in embedded?
Oh, I'm trying to remember which ones the guys were doing. Way back, we're using JFFS2. The journaling flash file system in Linux was actually not journaling. We had problems. Our biggest run rate customer was building control equipment, industrial equipment. A lot of what they did was injecting chemicals into the output of factories, where typically it's very acidic and, you know, pH of 3, and the city says you have to be between pH 5 and 9 or something. So they're selling pumps, tanks, and control computers for that. But they're also doing a bunch of stuff in open pit mines in Australia, and that's where we hit the problems, because the open pit mines run off a giant generator. It's a 20-foot shipping container with the world's largest diesel engine generator in there, and Monday morning, 8 o'clock, they fire this thing up, and Monday afternoon at 5 o'clock, it gets turned off. Everything dies, including our computers. So our computers were power cycled 5 times a week, every one of them. There were corruption issues. Which file system do we go to, Roland? Yeah. We did a bunch of testing. We built our own controller. It had just a PIC micro on it, so we had AC in and a relay, a little display showing the time, and a random number generator. And we set a time range long enough for the unit to be mostly powered up, and then an amount of time variable up to a couple minutes. And when it booted up, it ran multiple processors, and one was writing files as fast as it could, and the other one was reading those files and doing stuff on them. So we had multiple processes accessing flash. And we took this little controller, and we hooked up power bars, and we had up to, what, a dozen computers on it? And it was just running and power cycling. And if they booted up, if there were any errors, they would log it. And initially, we were hitting errors fairly often, and we hammered away at the file systems and the shutdown code. And we eventually got to the solution on the Samsung 2410 processor, where over a period of a couple of years, we had run over 50,000 power cycles with less than 10 data errors, and of the data errors, most of them could be recovered. And there were only something like 3 unrecoverable errors. But Yeah, that was UBIFS with a lot of work.
Never seen UBIFS.
Hmm.
It's designed, I think, specifically for use on algebra, right? Same with IFS too. It's not a general purpose file system. It would be used on a static storage system. You might actually be using UBIFS without knowing it, just on Android OS.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Have you also looked at F2FS? That's that new Samsung file system.
No, not familiar with that one. So the communications and protocols, the embedded, the cheap micros have got more and more of that covered. The databases and file systems, they have the file systems, not a lot in the way of databases. And the GUIs, Linux is mostly out ahead of them there. But I think it's just a matter of time. We're seeing a little bit more happening in the area of GUIs, but they're very weak there. So final section, the opportunities. If you think Linux should be the operating system on all these systems, what do we have to do to get there? Talking about common stuff. Software tools. This was just a huge headache for our customers. The ones that were doing C and C++ development, I think we shipped a development kit to one guy where he opened it up and he had built all the tool chain. Basically our tool chain, they log onto a server of ours in Toronto and download some files and then start the build, and it goes out and pulls all the sources. It builds the entire operating system, the bootloaders, and the tools. And some companies started that up and complained to us that it took a couple of days. They said, well, what computer are you running it on? Well, we had this old 386 sitting in the corner.
There was one customer that was using a computer three or earlier.
Yeah. So that made a difference, the speed, but anytime they're going out to all these dozens and dozens of servers, some servers are down for maintenance or whatever, so the usual call was a day or so after they started building it. Well, it finished, but it has errors. We say, okay, this is really easy, hit the up arrow and enter. And you start it over again, and eventually they get there. Some customers never got there. Actually, we had one in Toronto. They had first Linux project. They hired a programmer. He told them he was a Linux expert. He couldn't get our system going, so then he told them, oh, our computers don't work. So they shipped the development kit back to us. Didn't want to admit that he really didn't know Linux.
We're using the open embedded system
Portage, yeah.
Uses the bitbake file.
Yeah, we were running Angstrom and bitbake. And the processors we have now, unfortunately, Freescale didn't use a normal system. What was that? LTIB.
LTIB is the next target image builder.
Yeah. Anyways, it was old. It's horrible. And we took all of their Linux development and ported it at our own cost over to, I think, Angstrom first and then Yocto. There are some systems out there where you get support, like Mentor Graphics and so on. These guys are charging a lot of money, and if you're using it on an embedded system and they don't have some features supported, they'll add it for a consulting fee, and it's very expensive. So, huge challenge. Linux is big, it's complex. There's so many options. For people that are newbies, getting going, integration is a huge problem. And then I already mentioned the boot times are a challenge. The tools, the processor vendors are gaining putting this development work where they're supporting the RTOS systems. Most of these low-end processors can't run Linux, but some of the higher-end ones can, but they're generally not supporting it. It's probably, from their perspective, too expensive to do. So Linux is losing out in that world. Not talking about server farms and stuff, but down the embedded space, it's getting squeezed out by all the RTOSes. And again, having the long boot time is a big big issue. So the
why does Linux have long boot times?
It's loading file systems, and some of these drivers take a long time. Some of it you should be able to do in parallel. And when you configure it to go in parallel, and it works most of the time, but sometimes it doesn't work because something finished a bit ahead of something else that needs to be the other way around, and so on. So I don't know. I was thinking there was I mentioned here the Freescale Design Studios lets you select which RTOS to drop in. It would be really cool if one of the options in there was Linux. Another thing is if they were supporting Linux and the software, including all these drivers, if they were oriented around maybe POSIX as a standard, since we really don't need more standards out there, and then maybe adapting these low-end operating systems to put a wrapper on them so they're all POSIX compliant. And now you could have a drop-down box of which OS where Linux is one of the options. That would be interesting. And then on the embedded system, if you could configure Linux instead of running the full-blown schedulers, maybe have lightweight schedulers, messaging, if using the example, if somebody's building a device that talks on a CAN bus where your biggest message is a few bytes long, you probably don't need to have a messaging system that can handle arbitrarily large variable length strings. And so on, being able to strip down a lot of the core options. So that's kind of the end of the discussion about what the problems are. We still want to keep using Linux, also interested in some of these other things. Looking at building low-cost terminals. I've always wanted to be able to supply a range of computers people could buy where the high-end ones would run Linux, the lower-end ones might be running an embedded RTOS. And from the user's point of view, you've got the same screen there, and just be able to buy as much compute power as you need. But what would make that really great is if you could have the same GUIs across the systems. The LCD and so on. One of the GUIs we're interested in, as embedded systems are moving from the resistive touchscreens to capacitive, they're way behind the consumer products, but in the consumer world, you build a phone and you build 1 million units a month or something. In the embedded world, you build 1,000 units a year. Getting custom screens built is a challenge. Companies are coming out with integrated cap touch on some models, like 4.3-inch and some 7-inch screens. There's a GUI called Kivy. I saw somebody's doing Python programming here. And Kivy is a new GUI ground up for multi-touch. And they're used in installations, museums, and things like that, where they have multiple people playing with stuff and moving it around. It's really cool. It's Python language. It needs OpenGL ES. Even the Linux systems we're building, we don't have OpenGL on those, even though the hardware actually supports 8 layers of graphics in the frame buffer, and you do alpha blending in the hardware. You can turn layers off, but you could also make them transparent and stuff like that. Would be really cool. Yeah, but that would have to be ported. Again, if we could possibly get the RTOSes so they could run some of the same stuff. And then when you need a serious system where you need more capabilities and so on, then you could run the Linux version if you're just using one that's basically running as a remote terminal. You might not need Linux there, but it would be nice if there was some compatibility to bounce between them. That would be an interesting Kickstarter project to buy the hardware and then have a big group of people working on the software to to support moving some of this stuff forward, getting the power management into Linux and things like that. So at the point now where I just thought, I guess not too many people here that are embedded developers, but everybody's familiar with Linux. So I'm telling you that it's getting beat up from the lower end with all these small real-time operating systems. What should the Linux people be doing with Linux to fend off these pesky little RTOSes?
The problem with Linux is it's made to do almost everything on RTOS. It's like targeted right into what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see there's a problem using the right tool in the right place.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of thing.
Can you trim Linux down though? Like, wouldn't you be able to make it just like a single RTOS type themed operating system?
Yeah. Well, like Brian was saying, Linux is so big. You know, it's hard to pick. It's easy to add code. It's really tough to pull code out.
Yeah, you're right. And we've done that. And that would be a big difference if the configuration tools let you disable the stuff you don't need. If it was easier to leave out the stuff you don't need, because that would also go after the boot time issues.
You're right.
So what you're saying is we need a microkernel.
Well, there's
I don't
a debate
think
about how much influence IBM has in the kernel.
Yeah.
They want Linux for their mainframes. They don't want Linux for their little things.
Yeah.
And there's debate about their influence in the way the kernel is going.
Yeah. So I was suggesting the option of being able to select actually which kernel is doing the scheduling, whether you need the full-featured one or putting a simple one.
A 2.4 kernel.
But I don't think the kernel itself is that big in terms of code size, right? Yeah. It's all the stuff around it. If you could.
Okay, if it's the stuff around it, it's the, so you haven't tried, so you've pulled it down to reduce the loadable mod, like to reduce it down to the bare necessity of in the options.
There's one of our competitors for selling embedded boards. They used to put, they had this ad, their Linux on ARM computers would boot in 4 seconds. And then when you read the fine print, they had no networking, no communications, there were no file systems, and no GUIs. So you had a computer that booted to a serial console in 4 seconds. We're like, what's the point? If that's all I needed, I would put a PIC micro in there. So. As soon as you put the other stuff on, now it's half minute boot time on a 500 megahertz processor.
So even customizing it to the hardware, it still has the 6:30.
Yeah, you can rip out stuff and speed it up, but it's really hard work. If there were tools there to make that easier, that would help a lot. But as you said, there's a lot of tools for adding on things.
Yeah.
There aren't tools for ripping out stuff.
Are you actually comparing the boot time of the RTOS to the boot time of Linux? But on the same hardware configuration? I thought it was actually a different hardware. Right?
Well, talking about small processors, I'd like to put RTEMs on like our ARM9 boards, or the next board we do is probably the Freescale Solo Lite, which is a gigahertz Cortex A9. What I'd like to do is take a fast booting small kernel like RTEMs, have that on every computer board, and it would be the bootloader for Linux. You could run that alone, or you could run Linux, or maybe you've got a device that's going to be out in the field doing some data collection and communications, and you're only at the GUI when people are doing some configurations or looking at something, and run from the RTOS. And then one of the flavors of real-time Linux, the company in Arizona or New Mexico, they have a patent on their system where they run a real-time operating system, and then Linux is run as one of the tasks in the RTOS. So you've got the RTOS there for the speed, and then Linux for all the Linux features. But they managed to get a patent on that. The good old American patent system.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't know when that expires. Yeah, that's another option. Then you've got all the multi-core processors now, so you could put an RTOS on one. And then we've got things like the Vibrid chips from Freescale, where they have a Cortex M3 or M4, and then they have the heavy-duty processor with all the MMUs for Linux or Android for doing your GUIs. The other one's doing the real-time code, so when the screen's off on your phone, it's still going to communicate to the cell towers and switch cell towers when you're traveling, and they're going to do all that stuff with the radio off of the little micro that's running 80 megahertz or something, and as soon as you want to run Android, then you kick off the multi-core gigahertz processor. Atmel has chips like that as well. So there's a different solution where you put both of them in there at the same time, and that would be an expensive solution in the past, but that's actually getting more and more cost effective.
What's your favorite Linux distro?
Was I running on the laptops? I was, you know, Mandrake and stuff. I'm running Mint now. I used to be Ubuntu till they messed up the user interface and
until they messed up what?
The user interface.
Oh yeah, Unity. Yeah,
yeah, Unity. Not a fan of Unity.
That's the reason why I switched to XFCE.
Yeah. Actually I like Bodhi. Run Bodhi with XFCE on the older computers. Yeah, I think there's different options. Was I using Enlightenment? Yeah, I don't know. I just use it.
Yeah. It's
got a
HUD run menu commands from pushing the left alt.
Yeah, and then a couple of years later, Microsoft copied it and called it Windows 8, right?
No. It's different. I'm not talking about launching programs by opening the dash. The HUD
is just a bloatware.
Yeah.
You spend your time in command line anyway. Who needs to load?
Yeah.
That's right.
I don't know. Those command line games aren't that popular anymore. So. Yeah. I hate to look at the clock here. Oh, it's getting late.
Talking about
late
boot times and everything. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I spent all that boot time loading bloatware.
Yeah.
When you started out talking about clock cycles and number of cycles per instruction, that just took me back.
Yeah.
Been a long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, from when you're optimizing some loop and inserting some no-op
right.
Somewhere. So
debugging with an oscilloscope.
Oh, still do that. Always. Every board we make's got... There's one green LED, that means power. Debugging is simple. Green LED is not on, you have no power. Green light is on and red LED is on. There's only allowed to be one red LED. It's detected a fault and you need to swap it. If green's on, red's off, then that's where it gets complicated. But we have multiple yellow LEDs and, you know, there'll be a bunch on the board for the programmers, and then when it goes into production, there'll be one that's blinking as a heartbeat or something like that. But put a whole bunch on there. LEDs are cheap.
Yes.
And trade shows. There's nothing better than blinky LEDs.
Yes.
If you don't have a color display there. So,
yeah. It's almost like the world's best web page, a whole bunch of scrolling marquee.
Yeah.
Bib or Emacs.
What's that?
Bib or Emacs.
Not gedit. What was I using? I was using Crisp before. I didn't use those much. I used VI, I think, on Solaris systems at Physio.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, that was painful. I had that was a serious Linux shop, and the guys go by with the ponytails, and they're wearing Birkenstocks with wool socks, and they bicycled to work from Bothell or something like that. But for us newbies, they had a bunch of scripts they put on there, so it looked like DOS. You could do dir. So it's cheating. Yeah.
A lot of embedded systems probably use BusyBox, right? And BusyBox comes with VI. It doesn't come with Emacs.
Yeah. Yeah, we've had to talk people into stuff over the phone for VI and
it's
how to get rid of it.
A large part of the reason they made with switched from Max and Max to Max and Max back to them is because I was tired of Emacs not being installed by default. So it was usually always a VI implementation.
Yeah. Years back, I had a student programmer customize the keystrokes and macros on Emacs to make it emulate Brief. Able to get by with that. I've done myself, though, I've done very little of the Linux programming. I'm on the hardware side mostly and have other smart people doing the software. Actually looking for somebody right now. My programmer that was with the company for eons prior to the recession was working part-time, but he just took a full-time job at a different company. And the recession was pretty brutal. All our customers were in the US, so when their sales stopped, that means our sales stopped. So lost two businesses and a house, but starting over and having lots of fun.
So you do primarily hardware design?
That's what I do, and we're designing products for people. That it used to be we'd design products, sometimes do application software. We'd always do the customizations of the kernels and drivers and things and support them. Sometimes they have application programmers, sometimes we've done it. So the idea was we would make a bit of money on hardware production sales after the fact. And so we weren't interested in contracts that were purely designed where the customer is going to go off and build it. And now we've changed a little bit with this new stuff we're doing where we're only interested in designing products that are going to be accumulating data or something that's got to be logged somewhere and connected to the cloud. We actually started on the cloud stuff with one of the companies that I guess we've put about $2 million into Z-Point products for wireless building controls. And we had BACnet on there. We were working with Honeywell towards the end. We were looking at going into LEED's Platinum buildings that weren't quite done right and redoing the building controls to actually get them performing, stuff like that. But we were controlling all the lights in a big warehouse in Denver for Anixter Electric. I don't know if you've heard of Anixter Brothers. One of the largest cable suppliers in the world. They also sell networking cabling, so they also sell Cisco routers and stuff like that.
They have a shop here.
They were on just off Knight Street from Knight in Richmond. You would see them there. I don't know if they moved. I used to buy stuff off them 20 years ago. But they were an interesting client because they have over 3,500 warehouses worldwide. But once the everything was going well, and once the recession hit, just everything stopped. You know, half the people get laid off, things like that. But the stuff we're doing now, we want to design products where we're going to build the electronics, sell them, but all back-end cloud services, and also possibly remote control alerts and things off of Android or for the scientific instruments we're working on. They go around, they take thousands of readings inside a building, so once they get to a hotspot, push all the data up to the cloud over Wi-Fi. We would provide the CRM system, so the clients, before they go out to do an inspection on a building, they would have all the clients in there, they would book the appointments through that while they're driving there. We could be giving them turn-by-turn navigation. They get there, they do all the reports, get to the hotspot, it uploads all the data, crunches the data, generates a report, downloads the report to their phone or tablet, and they look at the report and click a button, yeah, it looks okay, it gets emailed to the client, and then we download an invoice to them, and they go, yeah, it looks right, click okay, and it bills the customer. We might even be doing the payment side where the customer pays them through our payment systems. So we're getting a little beyond the chips on circuit boards here, but that's a more fun part in terms of revenue.
So are you able to do all of your development work on Linux, or do you need to use Windows sometimes?
Development for software, it's all on Linux. We've used CAD systems before that were Windows. What are you using for development? She's just on she's on this laptop sometime, but she's doing, she's editing files and pushing them back on the server running Linux.
I think so, I don't know, people might
But on here, you're just editing PHP source,
oh, yeah.
Right? Yeah. When she's in the office, she's on a Debian system with dual screens there. She says she's not a Linux developer and she's configuring stuff, so her servers in Dallas are talking through proxy servers in Vancouver for stuff.
Yeah,
yeah.
Hey, I want to ask you more about those missile control systems. See, that was,
yeah.
See, that's embedded Linux
No, it's an RTOS, but the RTOS is compatible at the driver level. The software is POSIX compliant, but it's also driver interface Linux compliant, so they got to develop a very robust, fast operating system without having to develop all their own drivers, just steal all the Linux drivers.
Is it the same kernel? I mean,
no, it's got its own kernel. You're saying only source code? I thought the interface was identical, but I'm not sure. Yeah, good question.
Well, if the drivers are identical, if you say it's compatible at the driver level, then what's the kernel sits on top of the driver, right? So,
it's loading the module, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I would guess it's source code.
Yeah,
I guess.
Okay, that's an assignment for after class and report back with your findings for the next meeting.
what it actually controls is navigation or targeting or what? You know,
oh, they yeah, they use. I know the. Yeah, the initial stuff it was actually controlling the missiles.
The flight control system.
Guidance systems on missiles.
Yeah, because they have GPS, they have inertial. You know, there's all sorts of data input, right? Some of them even.
Yeah.
Some of them even have star readers to detect. You know, they
really?
fly by starlight, right?
Really? Yeah.
Yeah. They have astronomical sensors on. You know, so they've been launched at night from
B-52.
Hmm.
That's
massive
classified.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Awesome.
I haven't worked on that. We did the computers worn on the hips of soldiers for the Land Warrior project in the mid 2000s.
What was the idea behind that? Why would a soldier need it?
Everything's digital, so they've got their backpack includes they've got batteries and computers in there and the radio. I'm not supposed to talk about the name of this client, but I could. They're second largest defense contractor in the U.S. and known for missiles named after a Native Indian hatchet type device. And they were doing the radios that challenged the U.S. military. So this is 10 years ago. They had, it was less than 100, but close to 180 some different radios going back decades, and all these different radios that they still have to support in different vehicles. Some are bolted in and portable ones. And the radios they were using for soldiers were about $8,000 each. So because of the cost, guys are deployed in groups of three, and they would have one radio between the three of them, and then there'd be whoever's controlling stuff. So they have this big problem in the middle of the night in Iraq or something. The guy with the radio steps on a mine and gets blown up. You've got two guys out there with no communications, no link to anything else. And this defense contractor had a replacement radio. It was a software-defined radio that was $2,000. So you could put one on every one of them and save $2,000 for every group of three guys out there. And the software-defined radios are really cool because you can flip the software around to make it a GPS receiver. You could make it a GSM cell phone. You could make it a Radio Shack walkie-talkie. You could listen to the AM radio band, do anything you want with one device. But everything's digital and encrypted, so they've got all this cool technology, but they still have a person out in the field with a speaker and a microphone, and they needed an interface for that. So our computer had, we're running, it was only 10 megabit Ethernet using Cirrus Logic, CS8900, CV, Ethernet controller, which is very low power CMOS, on a Samsung 2410. So basically our same, the guts of our standard computer module relayed out with the Ethernet on board, audio interfaces, the headset jack interface, a few buttons, volume up, down, channel up, down. And it had to be a standard off-the-shelf product. They call it COTS, commercial off-the-shelf, right? They don't want to spend on custom. So I had to produce a brochure for a product that didn't exist to make it a standard product. And then they wouldn't pay development, but they would pay a high price on prototypes. And I remember on Thursday night getting an email. They needed all this done on Friday morning, and the guy in charge says, can you do a small change on that? I said, what's that? He says, put a GPS receiver on it. So the computers we produced were two-thirds the size of a business card. And they had all those features on it. It had a bunch of power supplies, about five different voltages, and we were into a few protos, then dozens of protos, and then hundreds of protos. They were going to do a pilot run of over 10,000 units. And we were some type of thing in their contract, a core component with a long lead time. So we were about to get our biggest purchase order ever, over $1 million for these boards. And then the funding got blown away. Does anyone remember Katrina? Congress, we were gonna get the order in the spring, and Katrina was the prior October. And springtime, Congress decided we're going to provide hurricane relief to these people in New Orleans, and it's coming from this project, X. Yeah, that's the fun of a military project. So we've done a few since then. Never ever hold my breath waiting for an order to come in on a military project. We also
How long did their batteries last? I mean, that's what I often wonder. You know, you hear about all this battery-operated electronic gadgetry. You know?
Yeah, that's a big challenge because
you're giving the infantry guys drones with cameras now, right? What happens when the power dies? You know?
Yeah, it's a big problem because they've got a maximum weight for the backpack. And as it was explained to me, there's three things in the backpack: food, electronics, gear, and bullets. Yeah, and bullets are highest priority to the people pushing the orders out, and food for the people that are running around carrying this stuff, and the electronics to make them all talk and stuff. This is actually part of a big project called ELPRS, Electronic Location Position Reporting System. Very heavy duty encryption on the communications, because basically you're giving the commanding people would be looking at a screen like Google Maps, and they would have one icon for tanks and another one for different vehicles, and then other ones for the where the soldiers are. And if the enemy were to intercept this stuff, they would know where to fire.
that brings up another point. Everything is wireless, so why? It's susceptible to jamming. You can encrypt the hell out of it, but if you jam, if it's all jammed, I mean, it's far easier to jam than to decrypt, right? So,
yeah, that's a problem.
All this gear, all this stuff that they produce is great against the backwater rebels, but you'd be darn sure the Russians and the Chinese would say, fuck you, right? Yeah. take this.
Yeah.
You mean the symbols on the backs of the World War I soldiers?
Yeah. Do you want to know how to build a military compatible Wi-Fi device?
Yes, sure.
So if you're 2.4 gigahertz, you've got your 16 or whatever number of channels there that are spread on 50 megahertz or something, so lumps.
50 megahertz spread each way. Yeah,
yeah, for each channel. Yeah. Change your crystal so you're operating in the middle between those, and you now have a military Wi-Fi radio. That's it. They just use off-the-shelf components for everything. Yeah. They just alter the frequency of it. Yeah.
Just talking about Wi-Fi, they were I saw this article that somebody made a drone jammer, right? It's the 2450 gigahertz frequency bands.
Oh yeah.
A microwave oven, right?
Yeah.
So you can rip the microwave.
Hey, quick question. Did the Snowden revelation surprise you at all?
No, the backlash to him surprised me. a lot like when the Socreds were in power and the ham radio guy in Hope picked up the minister of whatever driving out to the Okanagan for the weekend on the old analog cell radios. Talking to another cabinet minister about these dirty tricks they were going to do to disgrace the NDP person or whatever. And this was intercepted and recorded, and he got booted out for a while. And he wasn't upset that he did anything. He was only upset that he got caught. And to me, that Snowden stuff is all the same stuff. Like, it shouldn't be a big deal if you're not doing stuff you shouldn't be doing. But
will all this stuff be powered by solar power?
Yeah.
Imagine they use water power.
Yeah, this stuff, the boards we have, these are all pretty low power. Our computer module at full speed is running ballpark 1 watt power. And a small solar panel nowadays, the ones that you put on the dash of your RV or something, or what are they, 5 watts or something?
Yeah.
So you could run it and charge it. Then it's a matter of what the peripherals are and wired Ethernet, the PHY. The Ethernet chips, they don't really build them for low power. They're all built for low cost, so they're a little power hungry. The displays, the challenge on the displays is the backlights. So there's one device we're working on. They want it sunlight readable, which everybody says they want. We don't know why they're saying that. And they don't want to have the batteries in there to be able to drive the backlight so bright. But you can get transflective. You know, LCDs are, the ones on the calculator are reflective. The ones on the computer are transmissive with a backlight. And then there's transflective, which is mostly transmissive with a tiny bit of reflective, but given that sunlight is really bright, you don't need much reflective. And that's, I don't know if you know LCD technology, but your difference between transmissive, it's polarizing the light, and the polarizing is actually the direction you polish the glass. So if you've got the back layer of glasses like vertical for transmissive and horizontal for reflective, you actually put it in at an angle and then you get both components. So we've got more transflective devices coming out now for displays. Some really neat stuff you can find in IEEE. Computer Society, people doing research for OLEDs back when we assumed that OLEDs were taking over next year. I've been following OLEDs since the 80s. But the OLED is proportional to how much you light up. So they've worked on different GUIs and ones where you've got a GUI that you flip the operating mode. So if it's if you're running battery powered, you're not plugged in, then you're going to go to a black background with light colors on it versus the paper look when you've got lots of power and stuff. So yeah, OLED is definitely better technology because it's direct emitting, so it's higher contrast.
I understand you had all the LEDs on white, and they use about the same amount of power.
Oh, it'd use a lot of power. Yeah, it would depend on the devices. It could be the same, could be more. But normally you don't have most of them on. So. Yeah, displays are power hungry. Okay. Thank you.
So I'd just like to remind everyone, especially anyone who came in late, there are